In 2005, I was on my way back to my unit. In the early hours of the morning, I hit a patch of black ice, spun 360 degrees, got hit by a car coming the other way, flipped my car about three times. Driver's seat came loose in the impact.
My horse was quite wound up. I remember coming across a tree and my horse ducked under the tree and my head hit the tree.
I just sort of remember waking up and looking to my right and seeing the girl that was driving sort of drifting off to sleep. The car span and shot across all three lanes of traffic. I think the car rolled a couple of times. It came to rest on its roof and I had my head sort of almost through the sunroof with all the weight of the car on top of me.
I went to sleep one night, it was absolutely fine, and then woke up and couldn't feel up to we're about there. Not long after that, they diagnosed me with transverse myelitis.
I woke up 5 days later. Everything kind of came into focus, and Dad was stood at the end of the bed, and I sort of looked at my dad, and he looked at me, and I sort of went, "All right, Dad," and he went, "You all right, boy?" He said, "Well, you've suffered a spinal injury," and he said, "Well, you're never going to walk again."
I was completely paralysed from the neck downwards, and suddenly thought, actually, this is quite serious.
It gradually started to get worse, and lack of sensation was moving up and up. The steroids wasn't working, and at that point then, it was like, I'm really ill.
I remember going along the corridor in a wheelchair and watching the fluorescent lights flash by. And then eventually, I remember seeing John. I was laughing and he was absolutely in tears.
Pretty difficult day. It was the first day that I spent in a wheelchair. You know, it's quite a momentous day. You think when you've spent 2 months in bed, you just can't wait to get out. Being in a wheelchair meant I was disabled, and that was a massive leap. So mentally, it had a huge impact on me.
One of the doctors came down onto the ward and showed me the pictures, the scans. It was like somebody had told me, it's broken, it can't be fixed. And then I realised that I definitely wasn't going home walking.
Unfortunately, when you're in the forces, you don't have a career that you can go back to. It's over, it's done. I was in bed rest for 3 months, so I had not much to do but stare at the ceiling and contemplate, you know, my world and my fate and everything that comes with spinal cord injury. I'd say the hardest thing for me was the last day that I wore my uniform. I cried in the shower for 20 minutes. You know, I well up when I think about it. It was the hardest day of my life, genuinely hardest day of my life. I'll miss it forever.
My relationship broke down. I lost my job. I lost my home. I could never go back to my home because it was inaccessible. I lost everything.
The biggest impact is I can't give my wife a child. That, for me, is massive.
I've been lucky to benefit from quite a few of the services that have been available for spinal injury, the support work. The Spinal Injuries Association helped my mum hugely as a resource for information and services that they could point us in the right direction to.
My husband and I read the SIA magazine every time it came out and picked things up from it. If it wasn't for forums to go on and read and look at, you really are on your own.
With the SII, they've changed like my perception of disability loads, and they really what sort of told me, you know, get back out there, you need to just keep on living life really.
SIA supported me all the way through. Now I'm the peer support officer for the armed forces, so I peer support anyone from the Army, Navy or Royal Air Force who sustains a spinal cord injury.
I think it's important to have these support services for those that don't necessarily see the light at the end of the tunnel, to know that there is help around and there are endless possibilities.